You know, I thought I'd start off a little bit differently this morning. I collected some dust from a ceiling fan. Now, I'm not going to tell you whose ceiling fan it was, but I had that dust in this little paper cup right here, a plastic cup. And I took a picture of it so that everyone can see. And I thought we would just do an experiment this morning. We're just going to stay here for the next 13.7 billion years. That's billion with a B. And see if this dirt from the ceiling fan begins to expand and eventually turn into a universe. And then out of that universe, an earth would form. And then eventually a human would come about. So get comfortable. We're going to be here a while. Now, on a serious note, this is actually not a bad analogy of what some people believe about the beginning of our universe. Do you know what I found that was very interesting in our study this week, or my study this week? Almost all scientists agree that the universe had a beginning. Let me say that again. Almost all scientists believe that the universe had a beginning. They just don't agree how long it took and how that beginning happened. Now, there are several theories out there that try to explain the origin of our universe. And probably the most familiar one and the one that most scientists adhere to is something called the Big Bang Theory. Listen to how one website explains the Big Bang Theory. It's kind of comical in a few places. According to the standard theory, the Big Bang, our universe sprang into existence as singularity around 13.7 billion years ago. What is a singularity and where does it come from? Well, to be honest, we're not sure. Singularities are zones which defy our current understanding of physics. They are thought to exist at the core of black holes. Black holes are areas of intense gravitational pressure. This pressure is thought to be so intense that finite matter, matter that can be measured, is actually squished into infinite density, something that can't be measured. A mathematical concept which truly boggles the mind. These zones of infinite density are called singularities. Our universe is thought to have begun as infinitely small, infinitely hot, infinitely dense. Something, a singularity. Where did it come from? We don't know. Why did it appear? We don't know. After its initial appearance, it apparently inflated. That's what the Big Bang means. It expanded and it cooled, going from very, very small and very, very hot to the size and the temperature of our current universe. And it continues to expand and cool to this day. And we are inside of it. I love this. Incredible creatures living on a unique planet, circling a beautiful star, clustered together with several hundred billion other stars in a galaxy soaring through the cosmos. That almost sounds like it's from the Bible. All of which is inside of expanding universe that begun as a singularity which appeared out of nowhere for reasons unknown. That is the Big Bang Theory. So if you are an atheist, you probably believe that there was something that existed. You really don't know what that something is. You don't know how that something came into existence, but that something expanded into a universe, and eventually you have life forms. Now, many scientists believe that our Earth is approximately 4.5 billion years old. So according to the Big Bang Theory, it took about 9 billion years of expansion just to get to our sun and to our solar system. Now, the Big Bang Theory doesn't seem to be mentioned in the Bible, although some people would disagree, and we'll talk about that later. So the question that we are going to answer or try to answer this morning is, how long did it really take God to create the universe? We are continuing in our series on the power of God in creation. And to help us answer this question, how long did it really take God to create the universe? We're going to look at two areas. The first area, what does the Bible say? And the second area, what does the science say? So let's begin with the Bible and see what the Bible says about how long it took God to create the universe. Please turn your Bibles to Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The Bible says that there was a beginning, and God was the one who created it. Now, there are two interesting points about that word created, and you might want to underline it in your Bible or on your outline. But the first interesting point is that most of the time in Scripture, to create means to create something out of nothing. Hence, there was nothing, and God created the heavens and the earth. And the second thing is, in the Bible, the only person who creates is God, because God is the only one who can create something out of nothing. However, the first verse of the book of Genesis also implies that God was in existence before creation. And from last week, we learned that one of God's attributes is God is eternal, which means he has no beginning and God has no end. He was there before there were even a creation. So you see, people who adhere to the Big Bang theory believe that something called a singularity was in existence before the universe. And it was small, it was dense, it was hot, and it was under severe pressure. And then it expanded into our universe. And believers believe that God was in existence before creation, and he created everything. So the question that you have to answer in your heart is, do you believe in something called singularity, expanded into the universe? Or do you believe that God, who is eternal, free, holy, unchanging, infinite, all-powerful, is everywhere, is all-knowing, is love, and is perfectly just, created the universe? You see, it's a question of faith. Both options require faith. So how did God create the heavens and the earth? You know, I debated whether or not that I should read Genesis 1 to you this morning because it's so long. But you know what? Genesis 1 is the very word of God. And if we get bored reading a chapter in the Bible, we probably shouldn't be here, should we? So we're going to start reading Genesis 1:1, and we're going to read all the way through the book, not all the way through the book, all the way through chapter 1 to the verse 1 of chapter 2. So in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and the earth was formless and void, and darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was moving over the surface of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, one day, or the first day. Then God said, "Let there be an expanse in the midst of the waters," and it let it separate the water from the waters. And God made the expanse, and he separated the waters which were below the expanse from the waters which were above the expanse, and it was so. And God called the expanse heaven, and there was evening and morning, a second day. Then God said, "Let the waters below heavens be gathered into one place, and let there be a dry land." And it was so, and God called the dry land earth, and the gathering of the waters he called sea, and God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let earth sprout vegetation, plants yielding seeds, and fruits bearing fruit after their kind, with seed in them on earth." And it was so. And the earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed after their kind, trees bearing fruit with seed in them after their kind. And God, he saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was a morning, the third day. Then God said, "Let there be lights in the expanse of the heavens to separate the day from the night, and let there be signs, and for seasons, and for days, and for years. And let them be lights in the expanse of the heaven to give light on the earth." And it was so. And God made two great lights, the greater light to govern the day, and the lesser light to govern the night. And he made the stars also. And God placed them in the expanse of the heavens to give light on the earth, and to govern the day and the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. And God, he saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the fourth day. Then God said, "Let the waters teem," I love this, "with swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth in the open expanse of the heavens." And God created the great sea monsters and every living creature that moves, with which the water swarmed after their kind, and every winged bird after its kind. And God, he saw that it was good. And God blessed them, saying, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the waters and the seas, and let the birds multiply on the earth." And there was evening, and there was morning, the fifth day. Then God said, "Let the earth bring forth living creatures after their kind, cattle and creeping things, and beasts of the earth after their kind." And it was so. And God made the beasts of the earth after their kind, the cattle after their kind, and everything that creeps on the ground after their kind. And God, guess what? He saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, according to our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea, the birds of the sky, and over the cattle, and over the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. And God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. And God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and rule over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the sky, and over every little living thing that moves on the earth. Then God said, behold, I've given you every plant yielding seed that is on the surface of the earth, and every tree which has fruit yielding seed. It shall be food for you. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the sky, and to everything that moves on the earth, which was life, I've given every green plant for food. And it was so. And God saw all that he had made. And listen to this. It was very good. And there was evening and there was morning the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were completed and all their hosts. So how long did it take God to make the universe? From a literal interpretation of our scriptures this morning, it took 6 days. If I've done my math correctly from a few websites, evolutionists believe it took more than 13 billion years to get from the start of the universe to the first humans. Now, do you know how big a billion is? 1 billion seconds is approximately 32 years. 1 billion hours, the amount of time we're going to stay in church today, is approximately 115,000 years. And 1 billion days is nearly 3 million years. So I did some multiplication because I used to be a math teacher and I like math. If you believe that it took 13 billion years to go from the start of the universe to the first humans, then you believe it took 4,745,000,000,000 days to do what the book of Genesis said God did in 6. Now that's a big difference. And you know what's scary about that 4 trillion number? We have to multiply that number by 4. And that is the debt that we have in the United States of America. But that is politics. And I'm not going to go there. Or at least not today. Now, I must confess that some scholars believe that the word day found in Genesis 1 doesn't mean a 24-hour day. Actually, this might come to a surprise to you, but the staff at Wheaton College, a prominent Christian university in America, for at least 6 decades, 60 years, have held that the days of Genesis 1 are actually periods of time. Hence, many Christian scholars believe that the word day could represent a period of time like millions, if not billions, of years, rather than a 24-hour period like we know. Also, there are many Christians who believe that God created the earth, but he used evolution, he used possibly the Big Bang theory to create it. And this is called theistic evolution. However, are they correct? You see, from Scripture, I don't think that they can make a case. Remember, Scripture is always our measuring rod. When you hear something with your ears, the first thing that you should do is sift it through the Word of God. What does the Word of God say? You see, if we can't trust the first chapter in the first book of the Bible, can we trust any of the Bible? So let's begin with Scripture today. The Hebrew word for day is yom. Everybody say the word yom. I just wanted to make sure that you were still with me. In the Hebrew language, a word can have different nuances. It can have different meaning depending where it's found in its context. And the Hebrew language has a lot less words than the English language. So when you translate something from Hebrew to English, you really need to pay close attention to the context, to the words that are surround that particular word. So how is the word day, or how is the word yom, used in Scripture? Let's look at the first place that we see the word day, or we see the word yom in Scripture. Look back with me at verses 3 to 5 in Genesis chapter 1. Then God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning one day. So God called the light day. This is going to come to a shock to you. But God called daytime day. And God called nighttime night. Don't we still use that same terminology in 2013? And then it says, God says it was evening and there was morning one day, or the first day. Doesn't that sound like a 24-hour period to you? Now listen to this. The word day, that word yom, is preceded by a number over 300 times in the Old Testament. So a number comes before day over 300 times in the Old Testament. Each time that word day is used with a modifying number before it in Scripture, it always represents a 24-hour day. Here is an example, Genesis 22, verse 4. On the third day, third is modifying day, it's an orderly number, Abraham raised his eyes and saw the place from a distance. Remember when Abraham was going to sacrifice Lot? They came to that particular spot on the third day. What does the third day mean? Does it mean some period of time? No, it means not the first day, not the second day. It means the third day. Every single time the word day is used in the Old Testament with a number before it, it always represents a 24-hour period. So why would it not mean a 24-hour period in Genesis chapter 1? Notice it also says at the end of verse 5, and there was evening and there was morning one day. So underline in your Bibles, evening and morning. You see, outside of Genesis chapter 1, that phrase, morning and evening, is used 38 times in the Old Testament. And in all 38 times in the Old Testament, it always represents a 24-hour period. Look at this example from 1 Samuel 17, verse 6. And the Philistine came forward morning and evening for 40 days and took his stand. Does anybody remember the context of that story? David and Goliath. For 40 days, morning and evening, Goliath came in front of the people of Israel and defiled them. Until on the 40th day, David killed him. The phrase morning and evening always represents a 24-hour period in the Old Testament. So why would it not mean a 24-hour period in Genesis chapter 1? Now, the best proof of a day meaning an actual 24-hour period is probably found in Exodus chapter 20, verses 8 to 11. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter, your male or your female servant or your cattle or your sojourner who stays with you. Listen to this. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day, and he made it holy. Look at verse 11. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. Who wrote Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy? Does anybody remember? Moses. So who wrote Genesis chapter 1? Moses. Who wrote Exodus chapter 20? Moses. You see, Exodus 20 declares that Genesis 1 really means that God created the heavens and the earth in 6 days. And the last verse that I want to look at that has the word day in it is Genesis chapter 1, verse 14. Everybody look at verse 14. Then God said, let there be lights in the expanse of the heavens to separate the day from night, and let them be for signs, for seasons, for days, and for years. Notice God here distinguishes between the word day and the word year. Hence, I think it is very clear from Genesis 1 that a day was a 24-hour period. God would have used another word if he meant something other than a regular day. So when you look at the word day in Hebrew, when you look at the word yom in Genesis chapter 1, I think it's very safe for us to say that God meant 24 hours. Now, there is one problem that I see in Genesis chapter 1, and I want you to look at verse 2. And verse 2 says this, and the earth was formless and void. If your text has void, you might want to just put on the top of that empty. So it could read, and the earth was formless and empty, and darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was moving over the surface of the waters. So in verse 1, it tells us, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. But verse 2 seems to imply that the earth was formless and void, or formless and empty. You see, some people believe that verse 2 covers billions, if not millions of years. So millions or billion years in verse 2. And this theory is called the gap theory. And people in this camp believe that this is when God created Satan and his army. And when Satan and his army fell, there was a cataclysmic judgment. And verses 3 and the rest of Genesis 1 explains the reformation or the recreation of the earth. But that is pure reading into the text. The people in this camp, is what they're doing is they're looking at science and they're trying to fit the Bible into science, into the different geological time spans. Although many Christians may hold this view, hardly any Hebrew scholar does, because it doesn't fit the interpretation. So what does verse 2 mean? I believe that verse 1, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, is a summary statement. It's the chapter title to Genesis 1. Now God is going to tell us how he created the heavens or the earth. Or in other words, how did he form the earth? Because it was unformed. And how did he fill the earth? Because it was void. So the first thing he did was he made matter. And then he tells us how he put that matter together. So verse 2 is just part of verse 1. It's almost like God created. He threw the pieces of puzzles down on day 1. The foundation of the universe and earth, all of its elements. And then the rest of the chapter 1 tells us how God put those pieces together. You know, I love the theology in verse 2. It says it was formless, it was void, and it was dark. When you see the word dark in Scripture, it usually has a negative connotation to it. In the first part of this verse, it says, it looks kind of strange. It says, you see words like formless, void, dark, but look at the end of verse 2. It says that the Spirit of God was moving, and that word moving is like our word vibrating. I can almost picture God behind the potter's wheel, forming the earth, forming the things in the earth, and filling the earth. You see, it was dark, but God was moving. It was dark, but God was creating. And by verse 4, it says, it was good. And that is what God does in our lives, doesn't he? Our circumstances sometimes are overwhelming. It is dark, but God is moving. It is dark, but God is molding you to the man or woman that he wants you to be. It is about to be good. So when we look at the evidence of the Bible, I think it's clear that God created the heavens and the earth in 6 days. Let me ask you this question. If God can create the whole universe in 6 days, do you think that he can handle your circumstances? Can he break free the addiction that your son or daughter has been dealing with for years? Can he heal that sickness in your body that the doctors say are incurable? Can he break that hold of depression that has been on you for a decade? Or let's say he doesn't break that addiction in your child. Or he doesn't cure that disease in a family member's body. Can you still trust him? No matter your circumstances? You see, if God can create something out of nothing, he can meet you where you are today. Now that we've looked at what the Bible says about how long it took God to create the heavens and the earth, 6 days. Now let's look at the science. What does the science say? Now I must confess something, so everybody look here. My name is Matthew Joseph Dickinson, and I am not a scientist. And if we had a scientist who believed in creation, if he believed that God was the creator, and he believed in a young earth, I think that he could stand behind this music stand, and he could give a talk, and he could give a pretty convincing talk that the earth is young. But with that said, if you had an atheist who believed in the Big Bang Theory, or even a believer who believes that God used the Big Bang to create the universe, and he gave a talk behind this music stand, I think he also could give a pretty convincing talk that the Big Bang is true. You see, no matter which side of the stage you're going to choose this morning, both sides require some faith. There are some things that we don't know, and we're not going to find out until we get to heaven. However, I'm going to do the best I can in the next few minutes and talk about some evidence that I see that I think points to a young earth. So first of all, people who adhere to the Big Bang theory are almost certain that the universe had a beginning. I would agree with that, so we don't even have to discuss it. However, the Big Bang theory reasons that it started with the entire universe in a little dense, hot space under pressure, and it started to expand. However, the question that they must answer is, what force made it expand? You see, they don't have an answer for that. Their starting point is unknown. There is no cause to the effect that happened. You see, if I go and I hit Robert in the arm right now, Robert's arm is going to hurt. You know why? Because I hit his arm. You see, every effect, that expansion must have a cause. But the Big Bang theory, it has no cause. Secondly, adherents to the Big Bang theory believe that galaxies are moving away from us at speeds proportional to the distance, their distance. Therefore, because of that, matter should be evenly distributed, okay, in the universe. However, matter is not evenly distributed in universe. Geller and Hutra, two astronomers, embarked on a measuring program expecting to find matter was uniformly distributed throughout the cosmos. However, what they found was something totally different. It wasn't uniform. Matter is not uniformly distributed in our universe. Listen to what Geller said, one of the astronomers. She said, something fundamental is missing in our models. Translation, she went, oops. So this should have shaken the Big Bang theory to its core. But you know what? It didn't. They just came up with something called dark matter. Now, dark matter is supposed to be, and notice I'll use the word, supposed to be 10 times the amount of visible mass to make up for all the matter that should be there that they don't see. But guess what? Dark matter has not been found. It is just a hypothesis. You see, the evidence didn't fit into their theory, so they just say that there must be something out there we're just not seeing. So we're going to call that dark matter. Now, there's also something called dark energy. Same thing applies. You see, if there's not something called dark matter, then the universe doesn't have to be billions of years old, and the whole theory is a wash. Now, some scientists even reject the idea that the universe is still expanded. So some scientists says the universe is not expanded. It's as big as it's going to get. But even if it's still expanding, listen to Job chapter 9, verses 5 to 8. It is God who removes the mountains. They know not how. When he overturns them in his anger, who shakes the earth out of its place and its pillars tremble? Who commands the sun not to shine and sets a seal upon the stars? Listen to this. Who alone stretches out the heavens and tramples down the waves of the sea? Thirdly, adherents to the Big Bang theory said that the initial formation of the universe was extremely hot. Hence, if the universe is expanding, we should find a remnant of major heat in the universe. Remember, it started off small, they think. They think it started under a lot of pressure and that it was hot. So if it was hot in its initial phase, that heat must be somewhere in our universe. So two scientists, Penzias and Wilson, actually found something called the microwave background radiation, or cosmic microwave background radiation. What is CMB? It's thermal radiation that fills the universe uniformly. Now, these two scientists were rewarded the Nobel Peace Prize in physics. This was supposed to be the major evidence for the Big Bang theory. However, a bigger problem arrived. Let me quote it to you because it's a bit scientific. The Big Bang requires that opposite regions of the visible universe must have exchanged energy by radiation, since these regions of space look the same in the CMB maps. But there has not been enough time for light to travel this distance. You see, because of the whole premise of the Big Bang is expansion, this radiation looks exactly alike on opposite sides of the universe. So these two sides had to be close at one period of time. However, they're too far apart. By their own calculations, it would take longer than 13.7 billion years for light to travel from one end to the other. Hence, they have a time problem. So what did the adherents do? They came up with an idea of something called inflation. Listen to what inflation is supposed to be. In this scenario, the expansion rate of the universe, space itself, was vastly accelerated in an inflation phase early in the Big Bang. The different regions of the universe, they say, were in very close contact before this inflation took place. They were able to come to the same temperature by exchanging radiation before they were rapidly, now listen how fast they said that it moved, faster than the speed of light, which is impossible, pushes apart. According to inflation, even though distant regions of the universe are not in contact today, they were in contact before the inflation phase when the universe was small. In other words, science proves that something is wrong, but that just come up with something else, some other hypothesis, to try to fit it into their theory. Now, I could go on, but I think that you may be understanding. Notice what we looked at so far. Something had to expand under considerable heat and pressure, but we don't know what that something's called, so they call it singularities. Secondly, in the Big Bang theory, matter had to be uniform, but it isn't. So they come up with something called dark matter. We haven't found it yet. And thirdly, in their system, temperatures shouldn't be uniformed, but they are uniform to a very small fraction of a degree. So they came up with something called inflation. Do you see a pattern? So what is the significance of all this? People in the Big Bang theory camp have to have more faith than we do. Their faith is just in singularities, in dark matter, in dark energy, and inflations, and the list goes on. Our faith is in an eternal creator God. Nothing proves that the universe is 13.7 billion years old. Nothing proves that God didn't create it in six. But also, nothing proves that God did create it in 6 days. But the Bible definitely says that. And it is a question of faith. In the book of Hebrews, it says, without faith, it is impossible to please God. So if we can trust the Bible that God created the heavens and the earth in 6 days, we can trust the Bible that one day Jesus is coming back to get us. Listen to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 to 18. Brethren, about those who are asleep, that you may not grieve as do the rest who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep with Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord shall not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall be with the Lord always. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. You see, one day the trumpet will sound. Beep, beep, beep! And we will hear God's voice. And if you are a believer in Jesus Christ, you will be caught up in the air with the Lord. Do you believe this? You see, if we can believe Genesis 1 is true, then we can believe that Jesus is coming back to get us one day. However, if we're not certain about Genesis 1, can we be sure that Jesus is coming back? Or what about Revelation 21, verses 1 to 4? and I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there is no longer any sea. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming out of heaven from God, made ready as a bride adorned for a husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Behold, the tabernacle of God is among men, and he shall dwell among them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be among them. And he shall wipe away every tear from their eyes. And there shall be no longer any death, no longer any mourning, or crying, or pain. The first things have passed away." You see, I don't know what you are facing today, and some of you are facing some incredible things. And when I think about you, and when I pray for you, it breaks my heart. But God is saying, there will be a day. There will be a day when there will be no more crying, no more pain, no more mourning, no more death, forever and ever and ever and ever. There will be a day when we will see Jesus Christ face to face. The God who creates something out of nothing can do a miracle in your life today. So how many days did it take God to create the universe? I think it's 6. Let's check on our dust. No universe. No little human in there. What are you going to believe? There will be a day when you will see Jesus face to face. Every knee will bow. Every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. You see, you just have to decide. Have you made that decision before where you have said yes to Jesus? You see, if you had, then when you see him, you're going to be with him forever. But you see, if you don't have a relationship with Jesus this morning, you're going to be separated from him for eternity. And you see, I have family members and I have friends that do not have a relationship with Jesus Christ. And the thought about that they would have to spend eternity without God breaks my heart. And I'm sure that you have family members and you have friends that don't know Jesus. So in the quietness of our heart right now, as God brings some of those people to your mind, will you just pray for them? And we're going to play a song, and then I'll dismiss you after the song. God bless you.
Journey seems so long. You feel stepped, but you've walked down all alone. Troubled soul, don't lose your heart, 'cause joy and peace he brings, and the beauty that's in store. How is the hurt of life sting? But I hold on to this hope and the promise that he brings, that there will be a place where no more suffering. There will be a day with no more tears, no more pain, and no more fears. There will be a day when the burdens of this place will be no more. We'll see Jesus face to face.
People of CBC, there will be a day. Amen? If anybody has a prayer request or a praise that they would like to share with one of the elders, you're welcome to come up in a few minutes. God bless you, and next week is God's masterpiece, so don't miss it.